A theory of stateless commerce. Case studies, including the examination in the previous lecture of the diamond industry, explains what stateless commerce is and how stateless commerce works. This lecture now explains why it arises and persists. Why are the mechanisms that were relied upon in the 15th century merchant fairs still being used in 21st century New York? Why do pre-modern modes of organization remain when much of the world has embraced and relies upon modern state-sponsored instruments to support commercial exchange? The literature discussed in the previous lectures has identified many communities that sustain exchange without relying on state courts. That is, they enforce contracts by exerting private sanctions, usually the denial of future business, and often social punishments as well, against those who fail to maintain good business reputations. Much of this research uncovered pre-modern communities that sustain trade through private ordering. But many others take place in a modern economy where reliable state-sponsored contract enforcement is reliable. And yet the merchant community deliberately chooses instead to rely on private ordering to enforce legal agreements. The persistence of what is essentially a pre-modern market structure in a modern economy challenges much of the conventional wisdom in economics. Recall Ronald Coase's famous 1937 query in his famous article, The Nature of the Firm, which asked, why some economic transactions were organized inside a firm, whereas others were inside markets. We similarly might ask, why are some transactions governed by public legal systems, whereas others are governed by private self-enforcement? What makes private ordering more efficient for some transactions, yet public enforcement more efficient for others? To develop a theory that can answer these questions, I review two separate but related literatures. First, transaction cost economics, and second, the legal scholarship on private ordering. Several economists have previously recognized that private mechanisms arise to enforce contracts where public instruments are ineffective. In modeling how a repeat purchase context creates a market-based contract enforcement mechanism, Benjamin Klein and Keith Leffler challenged the, quote, implicit assumption of the legal philosophical tradition upon which the economic model is built, that without some third-party enforcer to sanction stealing or reneging, market exchange would be impossible. Oliver Williamson put the relationship directly, writing that, quote, the incentives of private parties to devise bilateral contractual safeguards are a function of the efficacy of court adjudication. It was from within this perspective that Oliver Williamson, building upon Ronald Coase's seminal 1937 query, proposed that vertical integration is one solution to persistent contractual problems. According to Williamson's transaction cost economics, when parties to a transaction are cooperating within a single economic entity, holdup problems, monitoring difficulties, and challenges to coordinated adjustment are solved administratively. The firm, in short, is a particular self-enforcement mechanism and a form of extra-legal adjustment to contract failures. But transaction cost economics also teaches that firms feature certain organizational costs in addition to these beneficial attributes. Thus, there are economic trade-offs between contract-based exchange and firms, or in Williamson's language, between markets and hierarchies. Whereas hierarchical control offers more transactional security, market systems operate with more autonomous economic agents and thus benefit from greater incentive intensity and spontaneous adaptation. In short, although firms are useful self-enforcement mechanisms, they introduce certain inefficiencies that merchants would likely to prefer to avoid. The key lesson from transaction cost theory, as it applies to understanding when private ordering systems emerge, is that vertical integration is a solution to unreliable contract enforcement. And thus, any assessment of alternative modes of transactional governance must consider the firm as a feasible alternative. Public versus private ordering. As we learned when examining the diamond industry, private ordering and coordinated self-enforcement mechanisms can secure certain transactions that public courts cannot. Thus, like vertical integration, private ordering is also a solution to transactional hazards. But that also means that we need more than transaction cost economics to explain when enforcement difficulties cause merchants to abandon market organization and state court governance. We also need a theory to explain when firms are preferred to private ordering and vice versa. Conventional transaction cost economics offers one reason why private ordering might be more efficient than hierarchies. Private ordering is a type of market organization that exhibits incentive intensity and spontaneous adaptation. Yet reputation-based private ordering also exhibits some significant inefficiencies. Its reliance on the familiarity of its partners erects entry barriers to outsiders, thus limiting innovation and inviting collusive conduct. This unique trade-off to private ordering, the benefits of transactional security and market incentives, with the drawbacks of entry barriers, also allows for a systematic three-way comparative assessment of these alternative systems of economic organization: firms, markets, and reputation mechanisms. This expands the traditional transaction cost analysis beyond the single dimension between markets and firms. It incorporates the additional variable of entry barriers, and it extends the institutional analysis to the multilateral setting, in which systems of exchange are compared, not just bilateral transactions. The complete analysis therefore requires use of three variables: market incentives, transactional security, and entry barriers, to evaluate the three separate governance mechanisms of firms, markets, and private ordering. This represents an extension of transaction cost economics, even while the model retains transaction cost theory's parsimonious methodology and fundamental principles. The three variables and the three alternative governance mechanisms are summarized in this 3x3 chart. Specifically, it exhibits that private law and reputation mechanisms exhibit the benefits of transactional security and low-cost enforcement, like vertically integrated firms, and the benefits of high-powered incentives, like public law and markets, but also imposes the single cost of entry barriers that neither of the other two exhibit. The resulting model, then, depending on the needs of the underlying transaction, can predict which one mechanism will excel above the others. As an illustration, the model explains why the diamond industry continues to rely on privately ordered reputation mechanisms. First, the transactional hazards of the diamond credit sale preclude arm's-length transactions with public courts. Second, the need for intense market incentives preclude vertical integration. This is because the diamond distribution chain relies heavily on diamond tears to match buyers and sellers, much like any exchange market, and value is created by matching optimal buyers with sellers. Diamond merchants aggressively synthesize market information, respond to price trends, pursue potential buyers, and chase valuable sources of supply. The efficiencies of market organization are evident from the frenzy of the DDC's trading floor. And third, the industry has not been sensitive to innovation. The distribution chain from mine to jewelry manufacturer has maintained largely the same over the past several centuries. Diamond examinations and sales take place in person, and the human process of valuation and matching is not readily replaced by new technologies. Thus, the industry does not suffer terribly from entry barriers. In sum, the introduction of transaction cost theory to the legal literature examining private versus public contract enforcement synthesizes a predictive theory of stateless commerce. It allows for a three-way comparative assessment of markets supported by state courts, privately ordered reputation mechanisms, and hierarchies. And it also allows transaction cost economics and the scholarship on private legal systems to meaningfully advance each other.